and Tenny, and wanted to take a couple minutes this morning and share with you some conversation and some comments about the election cycle. Of course, we're past the first presidential debate and the clown show that turned into. We're in the midst of congressional negotiation over continued COVID relief, and of course, the Senate approval or hearings around the Supreme Court justice nominee to replace Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And so there is plenty going on, lots of uncertainty in a very charged environment. And many folks are rightly asking the question, what's going to happen? And perhaps more importantly, what does it mean to the markets and ultimately to our goals and investment portfolios? And so that's what I wanted to try and give you a little bit of perspective on this morning. And as always, do so by focusing not just on the headlines that are barraging us daily, but with some historical context as well. So let me set the stage by sharing a diagram with you here that kind of outlines what are the most likely outcomes of the election. On the horizontal axis here, you see the presidential election outcome, the blue being a win by Joe Biden, and the red on the right side being a win by Donald Trump. Certainly one of them is going to win eventually, and while it's beyond the scope of our discussion here to talk about the constitutional implications of a contested election, at some point we'll end up with either a Democratic or Republican president. The Senate is where there's some uncertainty, because right now the Senate, of course, controlled by the Republican Party, and with just a little bit of swing there, could flip to the Democrats. You notice on our chart here, the House of Representatives is not really in play, and it seems like from most researchers and followers of political outcomes, of all of the 435 congressional representatives up for re-election, there's only about 41 seats or so that are considered in battleground positions. And for the Republicans to win control of the House, they would need to gain a net 21 seats, which seems like a pretty unlikely scenario. And so that's why it doesn't factor too much into most of the analysis that is taking place within investment strategists and conversations like this. And so based on the outcome of the Senate and the White House, we have different policy priorities. Certainly between Donald Trump and Joe Biden, you couldn't get a more stark difference on topics like taxes, spending, or corporate regulation, for example. President Trump has talked a lot about his desire to continue tax cuts and reducing regulation. Joe Biden has made it very clear that he definitely would anticipate increase in certain tax rates, be it the top marginal tax bracket or increasing capital gains taxes on households with over $1 million of income, as well as increasing the corporate income tax rate from the current level to about 28%. With that said, I think it is important to note, because a lot of folks have wondered, should we begin making portfolio changes or account level changes or strategies based on potential tax changes? And I think it is worth noting that while Vice President Biden has made it very clear that he sees the need and would support increasing tax rates in certain segments of the economy, he would absolutely not, or at least has said that he would not undertake that effort in the midst of the continued global pandemic and any economic uncertainty or recession themes that continue to persist. And so it seems like even in the event that Vice President Biden wins the White House, the tax policy elements wouldn't really be advanced until perhaps 2022 at the earliest. And of course, that would be dependent on who's in the Senate, whether it's controlled by the Democrat Party or the Republicans. With this said, it does lead to the question of, all right, well, what is going to be better for my portfolio depending on who wins? And so we have a graphic for that here, which looks at the last 88 years of election cycles. And during this period, you see there have been cycles where the Democratic Party has controlled the White House and periods of time when the Republican Party has controlled the White House. Interestingly, there's 7 Democratic presidents and 7 Republican presidents represented on this chart. And the key takeaway you can see just visually is that the stock market has trended up regardless of whether a Democrat or Republican is in the White House. That is true. There are certainly economic and political challenges that have faced our country and faced the White House throughout time. But an important takeaway is that the markets and corporations and the CEOs and the boards that control those publicly traded corporations find ways to grow their value and accordingly shareholder wealth in the midst of those storms. So I think an important takeaway in this is just the perpetual upward trend of market valuations, regardless of which party is in control. With this said, it is appropriate to acknowledge that the stock market does tend to behave differently in an election year than in a non-election year. That doesn't mean the returns are significantly less. It means that early in an election year, there's often more volatility. And so you can see on the diagram here that during the primary election cycle, often the spring or leading up through the summer, which for this year has been dominated by the coronavirus pandemic, there's often more volatility because there's more uncertainty. But as the landscape begins to narrow, and as we begin to get some scope of, all right, it's going to come down to this or this, then corporations can begin to anticipate policy that's going to help advance their shareholder value, and we see things begin to trend upward. And so in a non-election year, the returns between June and the end of the year, or the end of the cycle here, are about 6%. And in an election year like this one, we see such flat market returns and volatility early in the year that the returns through the back half of the cycle are north of 10%. It is interesting to note that if you look carefully at the light blue line, or the line reflecting kind of election, the presidential election cycle, between September and November, there is often a little uptick in volatility, often accompanying tighter polling, greater uncertainty of who's going to win. In some cases, I think just greater animosity and frustration. And so that in a little bit is what we've been seeing lately with the market pulling back pretty notably through September. But again, the overall average return has continued to create good returns on average, even in the midst of election cycles. So with this said, how do investors often respond? And I think we've got a really interesting chart here highlighting one of the mistakes that often manifests. And that is that investors often sit in cash or move to cash leading up to the election, which is a timing strategy that often is not the most profitable. If I'll just describe the chart in front of you, year one is the first year of a president's cycle. So in this case, it would be 2021. Year four is the election year, or the year that we're in. And what you see, if you look at the green bar or turquoise, money market fund deposits, money going into money market funds or savings accounts, tends to increase significantly leading up to the uncertainty of the election. And then following that, the money swings and begins to flow into equity funds or stock funds. And it's natural to be nervous, but it's important to stay disciplined, because by moving to cash or sitting in cash when funds are flowing into equities means that prices are rising before you own those particular securities. And so the bottom line, as you can see in the shaded box there, is that investors often get nervous and move to cash in election year, but that is rarely a winning strategy. And that'll bring me to the final slide I want to show you here. And that is really some guidance on what has been the best way to invest in election years. We've got three scenarios compared for you of investors who invest $10,000. Now, spoiler alert, the best way to invest in election year has almost never been sitting on the sidelines. And so I'll highlight that one first at the bottom of the chart. Sitting on the sidelines, this scenario is an investor who has $10,000 in cash in January of the election year and essentially says, I want to wait and see what's going to happen before I invest the money. And so the election comes and goes, their money is safe in cash, and they invest in January 1st following the election. Now, the average value of that account over the last 22 election cycles, 88 years, at the end of the four-year presidential cycle is just under $15,000. In fact, as you see in the little circles on the right there, in 16 out of the 22 four-year presidential election cycles, this has resulted in the smallest account balance or the worst outcome. In contrast, the top bar shows an investor who's not concerned about the election and invests his $10,000 at the beginning of the election year, stays invested for 4 years, and the average ending value after the four-year holding period here is nearly $16,000. This scenario providing the best financial outcome in 14 out of 22 cycles. Interestingly, I think the middle chart is also worth noting, and that is just consistent contributions. This kind of illustrates what happens in a 401k account, where an investor invests $1,000 a month, every month for 10 months starting in the election year, and then stops. So it's still $10,000 invested. They stay invested until the end of the four-year period, and that account balance is just slightly under the average value of the fully invested investor. It's not the best outcome in very many of these cycles at all, but you'll notice it is also never or has never been the worst outcome in any cycle. So perhaps this is some guidance for you on the strategy that's most appropriate for you and your goals. The bottom line here is that staying on the sidelines has rarely paid off. And as we often say, it is time in, not timing the market, that matters most. I hope this has been helpful perspective. I'll just recap four key things for you. The first is that, as the first chart showed, election results have really had very little impact on corporate growth and long-term investors over time. The second is that markets, in fact, are more volatile early in election cycles, but tend to strongly rebound after that. Third point is that investors sitting on the sidelines in cash during the election year out of fear and uncertainty rarely end up in a winning strategy as investment flows shift back into equity markets. And then the fourth takeaway is what I just said, that time in the markets is often a greater predictor for investing success than timing in the markets. Hope this has been helpful for you. Stay tuned for our next video coming up. Thank you.